Oh, Hogs, it's amazing to see you. I'm talking to you all the way from Threadbo, following an 85-centimetre dump, hence all the snow behind me. Where are you?
Yeah, I'm at Venice.
You've been in lockdown for long?
Yeah, too long.
Does this idea of 85 centimetres of fresh powder behind me appeal to you?
I never walked on snow till I was 50. I took up skiing and I took it like a duck to water. I was sort of very famous up in Colorado.
You took it up at 50, that's amazing.
Yeah, it took it like a duck to water.
In the 80s, he was a national treasure.
That's a knife.
Rising to international stardom.
One word.
Hugs. And then he was gone.
We have got a little project on the boil, an absolutely fantastic new film that we're all going to be able to see in just a few days' time. Tell me all about it.
First and foremost, it's funny. It's well written because I didn't write it.
But you were nominated for an Oscar for screenwriting, Mr. Hogan.
Dean Murphy wrote this one and he captures that dry, laconic Australian comedy as well as anyone ever did.
I was nominated for an Academy Award once.
Couldn't have been happy. No offence.
Yeah.
It is funny. I've been lucky enough to see it. Tell us a little bit about the plot.
Well, the movie should have been called No Good Deed Goes Unpunished because it's like a mockumentary of sort of my life to a certain extent, partially based on some true incidents, but mostly fictitious.
Want to introduce your son, a Dundee Jr.
Will Smith.
Oh, I can't believe it.
Believe it, Paul. He wants to play your son.
I'm dying to know which incidents really happened.
Oh, some of them. I was hiking in Franklin Canyon and I was walking through the bush and suddenly two ladies come running around the bend in front of me and saw me and stopped dead and said, oh, thank God it's you. I said, what? And one said to the other, that's it's Crocodile Dundee. She said, there's a dirty big rattlesnake across the path just round the bend. Will you handle it?
I'm not really Crocodile Dundee, you know. It's the character I play in a movie.
But when you mention if you do something wrong and the reputation turns to custard, what happens now is you get cancelled. And this movie has turned out to be incredibly topical in that way.
It's also a little lecture on sort of just live with it. Go with the flow. Things will work out in the end.
Grandpa, are you getting a knighthood?
My daughter Amelia auditioned for that role.
Oh, did she?
Yes.
Well, she should have said the connection. We'd have grabbed her.
Well, I'll know next time. She did a nice job, but the little girl in the film is fantastic. But you say to her, I'm sorry if some of the things I get up to have made life tough for you at school. Is that something that you had to say to your own kids?
A little bit. But fortunately, you know, I had four sons and a daughter. They never got bullied at school, and my daughter never put up with it. She's tougher than the boys, so.
You have a knife, but mine's bigger.
That's not the line.
That's
not the line.
I've been doing this for 20 years. I think I'd know.
When you decide to make a movie like this, you call up John Cleese, Wayne Knight, Shane Jacobson, of course, because we love seeing him, Chevy Chase, Livy. Was it a hard yes from all of them when you first pitched it?
I didn't even pitch it. Dean did. It's his movie. He did all the work. But they all just said, yeah, we'll play. It always comes down to the script. If it's on the page and you like it, that's what ends up on the stage.
I don't have my driver's license.
And John Cleese is very hard to get. In fact, they told us when Dean approached his management, they said, oh, look, he doesn't do comedies, particularly if he's not in control of it. And then he got a call from John and said, yeah, I'd love to do it.
Do you guys want mints or...?
No, fine for now, John.
Oh, Livy!
What are you two guys doing next Tuesday?
You worked with Livy. Was that the first time you've been on screen together?
Yes, except when the famous photo which keeps getting shown over here was when Livy and I met the Queen. They were horrified that I turned up in hot pants to meet They call them hot pants.
To meet Her Majesty.
Well, like my mother. He could have dressed up nice for the meeting the Queen and there in his stubbies and torn off shirt.
What did she say to you when she met you and did she have anything to say about what you were wearing?
The spiel I did on stage was that I was drawing lucky seat prizes.
There's a fantastic four-course dinner for two at my place.
I read out the lucky winners, and of course it was the Queen and Prince Philip.
Now, I have no idea who the lucky couple are.
So they're welcome to come around and told them what bus to catch.
Just get yourself on the 174 bus from Chatswood Station.
And the Queen, bless us, she said, I'm sorry, dear. I said, I don't think we'll be able to make dinner.
We're in the the middle of this weird time where everyone has to go back through their comic catalogue. Your mate John Cleese had to look back through the episodes of Fawlty Towers, and people are deciding which ones were okay for we grown-ups to watch in this day and age and which ones are not. Is that the way things should be done? Should we be going back and cutting bits out, or should we live and learn?
Live and learn. By cutting something out, you don't change it. It happened. The most common thing I've heard with this recent wave is that sort of, oh, my show's had all these pretty girls with skimpy clothing on and sort of, yes, I did have. Yeah, lovely girls. But they were there usually to demonstrate what complete fools men themselves over perving on women. It doesn't worry me because I never set out to be offensive anyway. It was sort of comedy without malice. And usually I was the butt of joke in my show. Yeah. The thing about John Cleese, they're saying that they cut part of the episode where they said he was offensive to the Germans.
Don't mention the war. I mentioned it once, but I think I got away with it all right. So
Basil Fawlty was offensive to everybody. An awful man. He was supposed to be. That's why we loved him.
You did what?
Didn't do anything.
I mean, you've got to think about your legacy.
My legacy?
This film is going to be seen on Amazon Prime around the world at the same time. It was originally, though, going to be a cinema release. How do you feel about the way things have panned out due to the pandemic? Do you think this is a positive?
No, it's not a positive, because the great thing about doing a comedy movie is to sit in a theatre with a couple of hundred people and sharing laughter. That part's missing. It's better on Amazon because more people will see it, because if you put it on a theatre now, there'd be like three people there. People aren't going back to the theatre for quite a long time.
That is certainly Paul Hogan.